Today, we're talking about fluids, my favorite, my area of expertise. We're gonna do an experiment and then we're gonna understand why what we saw happened using maths. We're gonna do some magic, but explained through maths.
Hey, Duck.
Wow.
Here I have a sieve, which has some holes in. So when I pour, the water goes through the sieve. Right, so I'm not cheating. Fill up my pint glass, put the sieve on top, and then I'm gonna get this plate and position it on here. And now I'm gonna turn it over. There's something's gonna leak, but hopefully not too much. And now the magic part is I'm gonna actually lift up this and remove the plate and the water will not fall out. There we go. That was off the plate, that doesn't count. Somehow the water is completely remaining inside the glass. We've got the heavier fluid on top, the more dense water with air underneath. And now if I want to make it fall through, again, to show you I'm not cheating, if I move this a little bit, it falls out. So what was happening there was the surface tension of the water was holding the water in the glass and stopping it from falling out. Let's try the colander. Yeah. There's much bigger holes. Yeah, if you compare the two, there's definitely much bigger holes in the bottom. So you can see I'm not cheating. I need to put this on top. And then I turn it over. And now, if I can grab the handle of this, slowly and carefully. This one's harder. Ta-da! Oh, that was off the plate. There we go. We've got the water inside the glass being held inside the glass, despite there being holes in the bottom of the colander. And yet, the water doesn't pass through. It remains in this precarious position of the heavier fluid, the water, above the lighter fluid here of the air. And just like before, if I were to slightly move this, then it all leaks out.
Amazing.
Amazing, I agree. So the last thing I've got is this sort of gauze kind of thing. And again, we can like pour the water through. So these holes are quite big, right? Now let's try this, see if we can get this one to work. My stopper on top, then my plate. There's gonna be quite a lot of leakage, I think, here. Okay. Can't do that, I kind of got it. Ah, no, it's not gonna work. I've tried this a few times, this one doesn't work. I was trying to build the suspense. So the problem here is the holes are too big, basically is what's happening. So we started with our very fine mesh on the sieve. So the holes there are tiny, tiny little holes. So we had the bigger holes for the colander here, and then seems like, well, let's keep going. We went bigger to the gauze, but this time the holes were too big. The surface tension wasn't able to support the heavier fluid being on top and the water fell through. That to me sounds like we need to investigate this mathematically.
It's actually like looking through the window.
Yeah, I told you, he comes to say hello. So what we had in our experiment was actually a two-layer fluid system. This is my interface, and this is important. Water on top, and then we had air below. So two different fluids, and we're gonna call the density at the top rho T. So we use rho for density, and T means top, and then the bottom rho B. So obviously in our experiment, we had rho T. Water is more dense, heavier than air. Along the interface, we've also got surface tension, T. And surface tension, the reason I've drawn it like this, is it acts tangentially, it's along the tangent of our shape of our surface. And we want to figure out now, can we derive a mathematical expression explaining the forces and what's going on either side of this interface? And can we figure out why we're okay for small holes, but past a certain critical hole size, it actually fell through? Because we're talking about fluids, we've got Navier-Stokes equations. I love Navier-Stokes. But what's really key here is to think about this interface, which is why I was keen to label this, because it's the conditions on the interface that really determine what's happening here. So what we've got is a boundary condition, which we call the dynamic BC for boundary condition. And now this tells us that on the interface, we must have a force balance.
They just must always balance, or they must balance for the water to stay?
They actually must balance anyway, because, and this comes from Newton's second law, because Newton's second law says F equals ma. The net force is mass times acceleration. But our interface, it's like infinitely thin. Like I can draw this, but does it have a mass? It doesn't have a mass. You can make the mass of it is basically zero. So if this side of Newton's second law is zero, the net force has to be zero. So in order to not contradict Newton's second law of motion, this must be true. As I said, dynamic boundary condition, the forces must balance. And we've got tension, we've got this difference in density, and of course we've got gravity pointing us down. That's going to be the other key force. And then we have a second boundary condition, which is called the kinematic boundary condition. And this tells you that fluid particles on the interface must remain there. So this is saying, if I imagine there sort of being particles of fluid all bunched up along here, as time progresses, this particle can't jump out and have another one replace it, because the interface is the boundary, the particles on the top, and then if one of them moves, if that would move down, your interface would move down. That's kind of what the kinematic boundary condition is saying. So there's some kind of physical intuition. Hopefully it makes some kind of sense. We were saying that if you are on the interface, then you have to stay there. And now, given these two important conditions along the interface, and given Navier-Stokes, we can actually write down our equation that's going to control the shape of the interface, because that's going to be key in determining when the water can and can't fall through.
I guess that's the lady duck, isn't it?
I think, yeah, because the other ones are like green, aren't they? Yeah, the mallard duck.
There's the man.
I told you there was a pair. The equation that we end up with, omega squared, is equal to the density difference between our fluids times gravity. So that's like our gravitational force, plus surface tension multiplied by 2 pi divided by the wavelength squared, all multiplied by 2 pi over the wavelength, and then the whole thing divided by the sum of the densities. Now, the densities are given by our setup. T is surface tension, and G is gravitational acceleration. So the other things that we've introduced here are omega and lambda. So omega, this is the frequency of our waves. So this is along our interface, where we have this wave-like shape. This is us saying, if I fix a position, then I let time progress, I'm looking at my interface, the waves will kind of move along in time. So you can imagine, let's take a fairly gentle, still day at the ocean. So there are waves along the surface of the ocean. And if you look at a certain patch, there would be a frequency, number of waves per second. So this is the frequency of those waves. And here it's the frequency of the waves along the interface. The shape of the wave is represented by lambda, which is the wavelength. So that horizontal distance there is equal to lambda. Lambda is the wavelength. The frequency in time is omega. And the reason we're talking or interested in waves is, if this is going to exist, if this actual situation with water on the top and air on the bottom, if this is going to be possible and like sit there stable, to sit there nice and happy, you need waves along the interface. It's not going to be flat. Like, these interfaces aren't perfectly flat. There's going to be some, even if you have to zoom in to almost microscopic level, there's some wiggliness to that interface. And we want to model this as though it's a wave. So like adding together causes and signs and things.
Why does it have to be a wave? Why can't it just be some amorphous, random...
So it possibly could, but something that we can show mathematically, which I'm not going to go into, but you can actually use Fourier series, which is you add together more and more signs and causes, and you can create any shape that you want. So you can literally have something that's really spiky or like a square. You just add together causes and signs in the right way through this theory of Fourier series. So you can always use cause and sign, which we think of as waves. So when I say waves, it's not perfectly like this, but we're talking about cause and sign oscillations, sort of like the trigonometric graphs. This tells us that if waves are to exist, then this formula is true. And that would be stable. That would mean that this thing sort of holds. If waves can't exist, then, as in the water falls through, then we can't have waves, right? It's something else is happening. It would be, you could think of it as either some like random motion, some chaos, some growth of the wave, whatever's happening, it's not nice and gentle and oscillating.
The system collapsed.
Yes, the system collapsed, the system breaks, exactly. And what we can do now from this equation, in fact, is think about when that can happen. This is a square number, so we want to square root to find the frequency of our waves, number of waves per second. If this thing is negative, then I get a frequency that's an imaginary number. And that's a clue that the system is breaking or collapsing and everything. Like, that's just, that means the water's falling through. So for wave, which corresponds to stable, what we need is this thing to all be positive. Right-hand side must be positive. Because if it is, I square root, I get the frequency, waves can exist.
Yeah, they've just settled on my little patio.
I like it.
Right, so when is this positive? Case one. So everything here is pretty positive, actually, when you look. So we've got G is positive, T is positive, we've got lambda is a wavelength, it's a measurement, so it's positive, pi is positive, density is positive. So everything's positive apart from this minus sign. So in case one, we can consider the case where the bottom density is bigger than the top density. So this would actually mean I had water on the bottom, air on the top. So this is either an actual normal way of holding a glass of water, so you're going to drink it, or this is like the air in the ocean. This is nice and stable, and because the heavier fluid is on the bottom, this is always positive, which is why we always get waves. So that's why you sort of, you know, the ocean is in general nice and well behaved, and why you can have a glass of water and it's never going to jump out or anything crazy is going to happen. It just sits there happily because the heavier fluid is on the bottom. So it's always good to do a sanity check with these things because we know the physics. We have the intuition as people going about our lives. So you want to check the maths actually fits with our daily experiences. I wonder what brought them here because there's no like pond. Case two is when we have the one we really care about here. Is when the heavier fluid is on the top. So now, if I look at my formula here for the frequency. So this, rho t, is bigger than this. So this thing is now negative here. So you've got something negative plus something positive. And we only care about the sign of this. So we don't care about the bottom, that's always positive. This is always positive. So it's just this square bracket. So if the right-hand side of our equation here, if that's going to be negative, right-hand side is negative, then that can only happen when the square bracket is negative. Rho b minus rho t times gravity plus tension 2 pi over lambda all squared. So when that's negative. Since rho t is bigger than rho b, we're going to take this across the inequality. So we can say that t 2 pi over lambda squared is less than g, and now it's rho t minus rho b. This is now a positive number. Top density is bigger than the bottom. Top is water. So this is now a positive number, this is a positive number. And then what we want to do here actually is T is fixed, it's the surface tension. So for a certain set of fluids, that has a value. Obviously 2 and pi are fixed, gravity is fixed, the densities are fixed by the fluids. So what we can control here is the wavelength, possibly. So we want to rearrange this expression for the wavelength. So we do that, we're going to multiply up, divide through, square root. For waves to happen and everything to be okay, we need lambda, the wavelength, less than 2 pi times the square root of t divided by g times the density difference. Where importantly in this case, the fluid on top is bigger than the one on the bottom. So we're square rooting a positive number, which makes sense. So this is it, this is our condition. If this holds, if we have a short wavelength, so their shape is quite condensed, then this will actually hold. We get waves, the water will stay in the glass and will not fall out, as we saw in the experiment. So now we just want to plug in the numbers to figure out why did it work for some of our holes and not for the others. So T, the surface tension between air and water, is 0.07 newtons per meter. Gravity is 9.81 newtons per kilogram. Density of the top fluid is water, is about 1,000 kilograms per meter cubed, for it being fresh water, and on the bottom is 1.2 kilograms per meter cubed. So there are our numbers, we plug them in, and we get that our wavelength has to be less than 1.7 centimeters. So when we have our glass upside down with the water and then air below it, surface tension is able to hold it in place and allow the interface to exist with waves, provided the wavelength is less than 1.7 centimeters. And the way we control that is by making our holes less than 1.7 centimeters.
So, Tom, the holes themselves are kind of physically constraining the wavelength, aren't they?
Exactly. That's exactly the way to think about it. So when I had the whole glass, it's like 10 centimetres across. So it's possible there for a 10 centimetre wave to form. We're not going to see it, but it's possible. But when we have the holes, they actually restrict, because as the water can't flow through the hole with a large wavelength, which it needs to. That's why for the sieve, they were really small, like a millimetre or 2 millimetres. So definitely less than this value. Then when we went to the colander with the medium size, they're about pushing half a centimetre, maybe 0.3, 0.4. So they're a bit bigger. And then for the last one, the gauze, so they're almost a centimetre, which still seems to be less than this. But this is just giving us an upper bound. So this is an approximation, right? We've, for instance, the very beginning, we assumed that the fluid was two-dimensional here. So I've just said it's a 2D slice through the fluid. So that's a huge simplification. And there's other simplifications we've made because we know we can't solve full Navier-Stokes, so we simplify everything. So that because of the approximations, this won't be perfect. But it sort of gives us an idea that there is a critical hole size, and if we go too big with our holes, we've got no chance. And so it sort of gives us a nice bit of maths to explain this apparent magic of the floating water.
I figured it out. I figured out why they're coming to your office all the time.
What is it?
Because of that.
The rubber ducky.
It's funny.